Hello, this is Kevin with Bang It Inc. And this is the final session of our assembly sessions that we've been building. And in this session, we're going to just talk about just little tweaks here and there that can actually make your assemblies a little bit more rigid and so forth as we go through here. So I'm going to right click and edit the assembly. And let's take a look at what we've done up to this point. So in this point, we've kind of done just straight insert items and putting things like just a phase item, one sheet of paper. We've went to insert and item tables, and that's how we got this to be able to swap between multiple items. So the system could ask me where the stud size is or wall height and pick, you know, particular pieces of lumber from the database and so forth. And we've also went to the selected takeoff where we were able to pick our wall sheathing and selected drywall where the system will just put us into the database at this default location and allow us to select something. And then we've also used if statements for selecting between them. So with that, there's a few things with this that I'd probably go back and recommend to make suggestions on. So if I run this assembly the way we had it right now, if I say that I've got a wall length of 100 foot long, 2x4 materials, bottom plate treated, no. Let's say that I've got a wall height of 45 feet. And I don't remember if it was 20, 22 foot. There was only a stud that was only about 20 some foot long. So if someone says they're doing 45 foot, I got my top plate, I got my bottom plate, and not a single stud was selected. That's a problem because there's no warning or nothing to let me know that nothing happened. So for an example, if I go back and look at what we did for that item table, we've got 8 through 24. And if you notice, the system will always put one greater than your last dimension. So my 45 foot ended up in here. There's no phase and item, so it returned nothing and it was all happy and didn't think there was any issues with it. So in my mind, that's a problem because that's a problem that a user could go through and actually select something, not realizing that it's out of the chart or something of that nature. It wasn't one I was expecting and so forth. It could just go on their way without really realizing that that was an issue. So there's a couple of things that I'd probably take a look at doing here. One of them is I'd probably put a max on of this wall height of 22 foot, since that's my longest stud that's in there. Now, if I was using the same variable for metal studs, and maybe metal studs can go farther or something of that nature, I might not do this. So there's a couple different ways of locking it down. So for an example, if I said edit variable, this variable has a minimum maximum. Maybe I'm going to say that my maximum is 22. Matter of fact, let me do that again. Let me take this out and I'm going to take that out for a moment because what I want to do is I want to say 22 and I'm going to say for this assembly only. So this is a nice little feature that will actually let you specify that this maximum minimum defaults are only for this one assembly that I'm working on. So for an example, maybe my wall height for metal studs are still going to be, you know, 50 foot or something larger. So in this case here, this is going to limit my lumber one to 22 since that's my limit here. So if I come back now and run this assembly again, and I left my 45 foot in there, when I hit enter, the system's going to basically blow an error message here and says, hey, the maximum value was for wall height was 22. You've entered something too large. So somebody could come back and actually put in, you know, something smaller and it would go on its way. So that's one fantastic effort to make sure to kind of go back and think about some of these variables when you're setting them up and what are really the valid responses that you're expecting, because sometimes you could just run into situations where somebody will answer them outside of your window and not get anything, which could get me, you know, short on money for my estimate and things of that nature. Now, I still have another problem here though, because I've got a 22 foot over here. I don't have a 22 foot over here. So theoretically, I don't really want this one to be able to be used at all. So that could be another problem of itself. So what I usually like to do is if there's a combination of one product or size or species or colors or things of that nature that one has that another one doesn't, I'd like to put something in all the void. So at least there's some message here to let somebody know, nope, this isn't going to work. This edit calculation is where we can do calculations unique to this item. So for an example, if I didn't do anything special, the formula does whatever here's behind it. So this formula would happen first if there's nothing in here. if I put anything in these calculation columns, they will calculate over this other one. So instead of the first one that I looked at. So in this case here, I'm going to say edit calculation, and I'm going to create me another variable here. Doesn't matter what you put in here, just something to give someone an idea of, you know, what they're supposed to do. Or I might even come in and help notes and okay, so you either have to take off this item manually. So you could ignore this warning, keep on going. It wouldn't pick anything up, and somebody could just come back and say, oh, I really need a, you know, 2x4, 22 footer. And, you know, maybe they have to add their own item or something of that nature, or you might have to do something valid. So that's going to basically kick in whenever that choice comes up. Now, another thing that some people might do is some people might also go back in and insert some sort of, what we did here was all per each. And some people might just want to pick up the cost. So they do have some items sometimes that are, you know, per linear foot. So maybe they'll change the calculation to calculate something per linear foot and at least, you know, get something to add some money. But for right now, I'm going to stop there and just see how that one differs. So now if I come back to that same assembly and run it. So if I set a 2x6, everything's going to be happy and it's going to go ahead and pick a 2x6. And drop it down in here for me because that one did have that option. If I come back and actually put in my 2x4, whoops. So answer the questions, 100 foot long, stud size. Soon as I entered that 22 foot wall height, now it's come up saying invalid. What you did isn't right. Go back and fix it. You know, whatever you want to have your message be and so forth. So, you know, if I go ahead and just continue on, it's going to go ahead and not pick anything up. Now, some people will put in little things just to be a nuisance here. So somebody just don't breeze over it like I just did there. So some people will say, okay, I'm going to default 0. And I'm going to put a maximum of, so that little game basically makes it where somebody has to be paying somewhat attention, because if I just hit enter and go past it, it's going to say, hey, this is not 9. So, you know, as long as someone put in their help notes, 9 would continue or something of that nature. That way you can kind of come back in and, you know, it says 9 to continue. So I could hit enter. So that way I've almost got to say, yes, I understand you're not going to take anything off, but go ahead and go past that anyway. So, you know, that's another trick that I've seen a couple clients do that's kind of cool, because that way it just forces someone just to not breeze past it, but actually you're going to enter this goofy, you know, 1, 2, 3, or just something that you're paying attention that I told you, you're not going to get anything. Now, if I came back up here and put in a valid response, that message just goes away. So very, very powerful. Let's take a look at the next issue. So the next issue I have is with that same table. So let's say that I did something real small. Let's say 10 foot, made out of some 2x4s, bottom plate's not treated. Let's say the wall height is only going to be about 2 foot tall. And let's say studs inches on center, 16 inches on center sounds good. Sheathing, no. Insulation, no. Drywall, no. I'm just going to leave it at this for right now. So basically, this has went ahead and it's picked up for a 10 foot wall. It's picked up 2 2x14 top plates, 1 bottom plate, and 8 studs to do that wall. Theoretically, there might be times like in this case here, I could take 1 2x8, and if that wall is only 2 foot tall, maybe I could chop that in multiple pieces and get, you know, 3 or 4 pieces out of that stock. That's the next thing I want to take a look at, is how you can have the system change calculations even based on different situations. So I'm going to go back into that table. Edit it. So here's the issue. When I said 2, 8 is the first one on the chart. So that's what it returned. So same thing in on any of these cases. If I said 8.001, it's going to 10. So anything larger than here is going up to the next size. Now, sometimes people don't like that. Sometimes there's these questions or something that I don't want someone to pick something that's not truly on my chart. So another little trick that I've seen some people do is they might do a... you know, whatever the invalid message might be. So that way anything between 8 and 10 is going to come back and say invalid. It's not on my chart or whatever the case is. So, you know, if you're really rigid that I don't want somebody to pick like a 8.5-foot wall and go on up to 10 or whatever the case is, you know, this is a nice way that you can trap pretty much any spaces out of that table that might pop up. Now, the other thing I want to do, though, is I want to come back and actually add a few more choices to it. So let's say that I have a 2, 4, and a 6. So I could do a 2x2-foot tall wall, 4-foot wall, or 6-foot wall. Now, in my case, I'm just going to go ahead and pick a 12-footer for all these. So I'm going to go ahead and right-click, and I'm going to insert item and go find 2x4x12, let's say, and we're going to drop that in here. And again, and again. And theoretically, you can chop up whatever stock you wanted there. I'm just picking 12 because all these just happen to be divisible by 12 to get me some numbers. So now my normal calculation isn't going to work for these. So when you think about this here, wall length divided by stud spacing. So if I said that I was doing 12 inches of 1 per foot or whatever the case is, and I said I had a 10-foot long wall, you know, that's going to say I need 10 pieces, but yet if I can chop that 12 footer in a few pieces, you know, this number can be smaller than that. So I'm going to take this formula because this formula still works for the majority of what's in that table. It just doesn't work for these smaller combinations. So I'm going to go back to this first one and edit the calculation, paste what we had before. So theoretically, if this is a 2-foot wall and I'm using 12 foot stock, theoretically I can get about 6 pieces out of that, let's say. So I'm going to take that dimension that we had and divide that by 6. So that actually comes up with a unique calculation for that one line. So this is real popular too. I've seen some clients that we've built item tables for things like insulation. And insulation can sometimes be a little complicated because some insulation might come per roll, some might come per square foot, some might come for particular board sizes and sheets of a product and so forth. So it just kind of is very cool that you can actually have multiple choices that could be selected and then have a completely different calculation on every single item if you needed it. And in this case here, I'm going to say, what is that, a 4 foot? So maybe we chop it up into 3 pieces. And we're going to say 6 foot. I could chop that 12 footer up into 2. And those are going to be the only ones I'm going to change because those are the only exception to the rules. All these other items, that calculation I had in the assembly will work fine. So now if I come back and take a look at this same assembly, said I got that 10-foot tall wall or 10-foot long wall that was 2 foot tall. Now it's only going to give me 2 2x12s because it's going to figure I'm going to chop it into smaller pieces to get it to all fit and so forth. So those can just be a very powerful way of coming back and putting a little bit of fine tuning on your item tables to make them a little bit more robust in what they can actually, you know, trap someone into getting the right response or getting the right option select and so forth. One last thing I want to take a look at this session is I want to take a look at my database briefly. And I need to learn what's in this database a little bit. So I'm going to come back and I want to do something with, you know, we did something with 2 variables. And one of the things that's also very powerful about the system and these item tables is you can actually do multiple variables. So, you know, single variable, 2 variable, pretty easy. But if you know the trick, you can build an indefinite number of variables into your item table, it would be. So if I go back and let's take a look at where's my actual studs himself. Let's say right here. So I'm going to make a note here that I'm looking at 9251, let's say. So it looks like my database has 14 gauge, 3 5/8, and it looks like they've got links of 8, 9, 10, 11, 12. 8, 9, 10, 11, 12. And then it looks like they go to 4 6-inch. So 4 6-inch. And then they go to 16 gauge, 18 gauge, 20 gauge. Okay. So what I want to do is I want to build one item table that has all this stuff in it. So theoretically, I need to know the gauge, one variable. I need to know the stud size, a second variable. And I need to know the height of the wall, a third variable. So this concept can be used for as many different variables as you need into your tables. So for an example, let's go back and build this thing. So I'm going back to database, assemblies. I'm going to hit add. So I'm going to say metal stud, insert, item table, right click. I want to go off and create an item table. So first variable. Well, I don't want a variable. So in this case here, I don't want a single question. So in my example, I'm going to build all of this three questions with one variable, with one dimension of this item table. So in this case, I'm going to say that I don't want a variable. I need a formula. And I'm going to go through and say that I want to create a formula. And this is going to end up having what? The gauge, the size, and the height all in one when I get done with it. So you can call it whatever you want for a name. So I'm going to start easy. So I'm going to just say wall height. So I'm kind of starting with my tightest variable in my database list because mine was organized first by gauge, then by size, and then by wall height. So when I look at wall height, if I just ran that formula by itself, whatever I put in, so if I said I had a 10-foot wall, it's going to return 10. Now, knowing this wall height, I don't know what my metal studs are set up for, but I'm going to say that this wall height, I'm not going to do anything over 100 foot long. So I'm going to say that this wall height has a maximum of 99, or basically two characters. So if I take this wall height plus metal stud size, let's say. So let's look at this variable. So this variable, I got 3 3 5/8, 4 4 inch, 6 6-inch. I got a maximum of 6, minimum of 3. That works perfect for my situation here. I can also tell that this is one more character being added to the mix. So for an example, this was 2. I'm going to take metal stud size times 2 zeros or 100. So what that's going to do is it's really going to move this number over two places to the left. So when I add these together, that'll come up with a unique code that the first part of it's going to be my metal stud size. The second part of it's going to be my wall height. So if I take a look at that formula here and I test this, I've got a wall that's, let's say, 12 foot, metal stud size 3. So that's going to bring back something that says 3 for my metal stud size, 12 for my wall height. So now that code is unique for all these different metal stud and wall height combinations, because I've just happened to move this over enough characters so that way every position of this number has its own meaning. So now I want to do the same thing and add my metal stud gauge. 14, 16, 18, 20. So that looks good. Max 20, minimum 14. Wonderful. Looks like just what I need for mine. So as I pick it into my assembly here, so I've got two characters here, one there. So I'm going to take this number times 2 for my wall height, 1 for my metal stud size. So now if I take a look at this, I've got a wall that's, let's say, 2 by 14 at a 6 foot stock or 6 inch gauge or 6 inch size. And let's say it's 16 gauge. So in this case here, the first two characters on my gauge, 16. 6 stands for my 6 inches for my size. and 14 is my height. So now I've got one formula that actually has combined all three of those variables. But if you notice, you can keep on going and adding more and more to whatever you may need. So this makes it where there's pretty much very unlimited number of combinations that you could put in these tables in. So the most complicated about this is keeping in mind, you got to start with the lowest number and work your way up. So since metal gauges are like, 20 might be smaller than a 14 gauge or something of that nature, doesn't matter. It's not looking at the physical dimensions of a product or something like that. It's all just by numeric. So my smallest number is going to be a 14 for 14 gauge, 3 for 3 and 5 eighths, 8. 14, 3 for 3 and 5 eighths, 9. And you get the general idea. So I'm not going to go all the way through this list, but you get the general idea. Let's see, 14 gauge, 4 inch going back to 8. 14, 4 inch going back to 9. 14, 4 inch going to 10. 14, 4 inch going to 11. 14, 4 inch going to 12. And so forth and so forth. So as you go through there, now if I come back and actually look at my list here, let's see, I'm going to get rid of that row there. Insert. Oh, what did I write down? 9251 is where we found those products. 9251, that thing right there. So 14, 3 inch, 8 foot. Starts right in the exact same order as what I just built. So basically, I've built out through a 14, 4 inch by 12. So if I take all those items and drop it, I could build that whole darn list in one drag and drop at one, if I had all my numbers in here and so forth. So that's kind of an example. And there again, I probably got a couple of them out there. So I'll change my name a little bit. Drop that in here. And I'm not going to worry about a calculation right now. Oh, I probably need to put something in there. Let's throw something in there pretty quick. Custom, let's take wall length. And I'm just going to say 1 per foot for the heck of right now. Okay, so if we go off and go to takeoff and run that assembly, and there's my metal stud one. So basically that's going to come up and ask you for wall length. Maybe I got a 16 foot. Wall height, wall length, let's say 100 foot long. Height is going to be 16 foot, let's say, of 6 inch product. That is of 16 gauge, sounds good. I went way beyond what my table had. So as you can see, this is why you always want to make sure you fill out all your voids at your table or you'll get nothing. So if I undo that one and think about what I actually built out. So basically, I built out only through 12 foot tall. And I only went through 3 5/8 and 4 inch. So we'll say 3 5/8. And I only built out 14 gauge. So we'll say 14. And basically you'll notice 3 5/8, 12 foot tall, 14 gauge. So that's went through that table and just found that combination for three variables. So very, very powerful way of just when somebody gets into just a bunch of different choices and combinations and things like that, just open the door to get that much more in those tables. And that pretty much concludes this session on just kind of taking those assemblies a little bit farther and some more customization on those item tables to get them to work a little bit better. Thank you for your time.